Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live again. A very blessed Good Friday to you and your family. Today is the day, if you are not Catholic or maybe not Christian and you're listening to us and wondering what Good Friday is all about, today is the day that we commemorate what we call the Passion of the Lord, the death of the Lord on the cross out of love for us. And so it is among the most holy days that we can celebrate, and in some ways a very difficult day, but it's called Good Friday because of the great goodness of God in surrendering himself for our sins. I'm joined this hour by our chaplain here at Catholic Answers, Father Hugh Barbour, and today, for this hour, we will discuss the most precious blood of our Savior, the most precious blood of the Lord, one of the core devotions of the Church, an important devotion. Father, thank you so much for being here with us.
Happy to be here.
First of all, maybe for those who don't know, what do we mean by devotion, and then particularly what do we mean by the devotion to the most precious blood of Christ?
Well, devotion in St. Thomas is one of the acts of the virtue of religion. The virtue of religion is a virtue whereby we attempt to render to God what is his due, but we can't. And So it's called an ex virtue to justice. We can't really give God his due, so we do the best we can. So the devotion is the act whereby we show prompt and ready service of God. That's the things that pertain to the service of God. So devotion is stirred up then by those things that most affect our imagination and our feelings.
Yes.
Now, intrinsically, like in the deepest sense, devotion might be stirred up by mysteries that are not something that can appeal to our understanding, like the Blessed Trinity, where our passions, our memory, our imagination. But what most stirs our devotion, and St. Thomas points this out, has to do with the mysteries that regard our Lord's humanity, so his infancy and his suffering. And if you look at Catholics throughout the world, throughout all history, the two things that move them the most are the baby Jesus and the crucified Jesus.
Isn't it true? Yeah, right. And as
and that makes them prompt and ready to serve God. That's the idea.
Right. That's what the creche does at Christmas. Then right. When we see it, it evokes something in us.
Yeah. And the crucifix does on Good Friday.
Right. Right. I think most people, when they think of devotions, if you said the devotion to the most sacred heart of Jesus, they would be familiar with it because it's very popular, I guess.
Right. Well, that's well established. You have in the church various devotions. The first devotion was to the Holy Cross because that's a symbol of our Lord's suffering. Then there was developed a devotion to the holy name of Jesus. And then later, the devotion to his Sacred Heart. All these things were marked by his own interventions to encourage us in these things. The heart of Jesus, of course, is really the center of everything, because the heart has his name, because it's his person. It has his human nature, and it has his blood, because the heart is the organ of the precious blood. And in the church's tradition, the Holy See required that when you depict the Sacred Heart, you should always have a little cross over the flames over his heart. And then you have the Divine Mercy devotion, where you show from our Lord's heart the blood and water flowing forth. So there's really and truly a kind of a coherence with all these devotions that come together. They all point to what would motivate us to be prompt and ready for the service of God in terms of our affects, our feelings, our emotions, our connection with the one who shares our own human nature, who suffered, who was sad, who was afraid, who endured all the things that we ourselves in our earthly life endure.
I wonder if, again, because not all of our listeners are Catholic, but or even Christian, one of the critiques probably of Christianity is how bloody it is, and how, you know, why all this blood? What is it about that we say God manifests his love for us in such a bloody manner?
Well, the problem with blood is that normally you don't see it.
Yeah, yeah.
And, you know, you can't exist without blood. Everything's in your blood. When you go to the doctor, they evaluate you according to your blood. everything that you eat, everything that you are, your genes, your DNA, all of that, it's all moving around your system, you know, according to the processes of your blood. Blood is the privileged substance in your body. And so that's why you should drink enough water, why you should nourish yourself, all these things. So I think that that's just an aesthetic consideration, that when people see blood flowing, they have a certain horror because it's so instinctive and intuitive that that's us, you know.
Yeah.
The blood is me.
Yeah.
You know, if you have your blood tests, they can tell everything about you other than your actual thoughts, but they can tell everything else that's not your thoughts. They can do it all. And so I think that there's a certain kind of natural human horror at having all that exposed. But in point of fact, we're constantly aware of the fact that our blood is our life system. It's everything that gives us everything we need to exist and survive. So we should just recognize it that as a symbol, which is not merely a symbol, but a reality, it's a very, very powerful thing.
And so tell us a little bit about particularly the devotion to the most precious blood.
Well, I think for Catholics, the devotion to the blood of Jesus reveals to them a certain aspect of our Lord's passion which might go unattended to.
Mm-hmm.
And that is that we are normally geared towards recognizing that our Lord suffered a whole lot for us, that he endured the weight of our sins, that he endured the pain of the passion, that he suffered death for us and died. But the theological mystery, which is like that of the Blessed Trinity that we confess as our supreme mystery, is that our Lord was the incarnate God. And so consequently, even though the particular constituents of his human nature could be separated, he, as God, God the Son, as we say in the Creed every Sunday, hopefully, if they're not using the Apostles' Creed in your parish, all right, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, that one, who for us men of our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, that one is not separated from any aspect of his humanity in the Passion. So anything that has to do with his humanity can be separated. His soul can be separated from his body after most of his blood or all of it is separated from his body. All the things that have to do with his human nature, they can happen the way they happen in accordance with the normal laws of human death and life. But according to his choice, he chose to die. And so he lost his blood and his soul left his body. But his divinity, that is his being God the Son, never left any of the constituents of his human nature throughout his passion. So his soul was still united to his blood. I mean, his divinity was still united to his blood. His divinity was still united to his body. His divinity was still united to his soul. So that what happened in the Passion was his human nature was severed in
yes.
its physical, its material, its bodily constituents, and in the union of body and soul. But in terms of the incarnation, his human nature was not separated from the divinity, so that his body in the tomb was the adorable Son of God. His blood trodden underfoot in the streets of Jerusalem.
Is the Son of God, is the beloved Son of God. And that's the astonishing, I do think.
And his union with his soul, whereby he descended among the dead to visit them and to bring them eternal life, is also united to his divinity. So his whole nature was always united to his divinity. He never lost it. So that the person of Christ, the divine person, was always united to all the constituents of his human nature, so that the incarnation is the only human being that was completely indestructible as a person. God the Son, his soul, that's the person born of the Virgin Mary. God the Son with his body, that's the person born of the Virgin Mary.
Mm.
God the Son in his blood is the person born of the Virgin Mary, so that we never have to confront the disintegration of the life of the Son of God made man of the Virgin Mary. So when Our Lady holds him in her arms in the Pietà, She's holding her son. Most mothers who have a dead son, his dead body is not the one she gave birth to. She gave birth to a live man. And so it's a tragedy. But Our Lady is holding, like in the Pietà in St. Peter's, she's holding the Son of God who is still there.
Yeah.
He's the object of faith, but he's still there. So that's the amazing mystery that is a gift to those who have a more penetrating faith in the Passion of the Lord.
It gives a different, it takes it from, a kind of symbolic understanding. He shed his blood for us. But the actual, if the divine person is never separated from that blood, it's of eternal, every drop of it is of eternal, infinite value.
Right. That's, yeah.
So like when St. Peter says the following, it takes on a different meaning. In Peter's first letter, in the first chapter, he says, realize that you were ransomed from your futile conduct, handed on by your ancestors, not with perishable things like silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ as of a spotless, unblemished lamb. That takes on a whole intense new meaning when you think of the precious blood as not separate from the divine person.
Right. It's not simply an image or a symbol.
Yeah.
It's the actual person that accomplishes our salvation. When you see in an image, and that what I recommend to people, if they could go and check, like Beato Angelico, the Dominican painter who's blessed by the church, he's beatified, and he painted all these beautiful images of our Lord and his Passion in the monastery of San Marco in Florence. And there he shows, even though our Lord's lying, hanging in death, he shows the blood as kind of pulsing and alive continually. And just to indicate that the blood is actually him. It's not just a symbol of him.
Right.
It's him. It's Jesus. And we Catholics, because of our connection to the Eucharist, we can kind of see that instinctively. But we have to realize that even in the Passion, as he shed his blood, as he left it on the streets of Jerusalem, the blood that would be taken up again in the resurrection, that was Jesus and not just a material substance that was discarded.
Right.
And this is right. Very important. Now, modern theology, modern Christology, if you want to go with all these people that, you know, everyone follows nowadays, they will not like all of this. But in the last ditches of theological discussion before it turned to the Protestant Reformation, there was a big controversy over this very question in European theology. And the church came down ultimately on the side of course, St. Thomas and the Dominicans. I'm not a Dominican, but let's just say they came down.
You always favor St. Thomas.
Right, always favor St. Thomas. That is that the blood of Christ shed in the Passion is really and truly him, not just, to use bad grammar, it's really and truly Christ and not simply a material substance.
So this is in the 1400s.
Late 1400s, right, exactly.
And so the actual question is about whether the corporeal blood of Christ is adorable.
Right,
is that
exactly,
right?
Exactly. And now the church resolved it because in her establishing the Feast of the Precious Blood, which is on July 1st in the extraordinary calendar, and in some places in the new calendar, it depends. But certainly that's very, very clear. And in the Litany of the Precious Blood, which was promulgated by Pope the Saint John the 23rd,
yes.
We invoke the blood of Christ, shed profuse in the scourging, blood of Christ poured forth in the agony, that we invoke the blood of Christ as it was shed in those events of the Passion. So it's clear of the church, and that's an approved litany, liturgically approved, it's by the highest authority, that we're invoking the blood of Christ as it's shed in his Passion, which means that it is Christ, because we don't invoke a material object.
Right. Yeah, right.
So it's a very important consideration, and it feeds our faith. It also helps us with our Protestant brethren who talk about trust in the blood of Christ, but they don't even have a clue as to how deep that trust should be.
Yeah, that Christ is God incarnate means that his body, though it is like our bodies, is unlike our bodies. It's more.
It means that his humanity, which is perfect, is its existence, its subsistence, you might say, its actual subsistence, is in view of a divine person.
Mm-hmm.
so that the thing that gives being to the body and the blood and the soul of Jesus, born of the Virgin Mary, is God the Son. And so consequently, anything that could happen to his body and his blood and his soul in relation to each other happens on their own plane, but nothing can break the union of those three elements with his divine person. And that's the indestructibility of the humanity of Christ in relation to his divinity, which made Our Lady the Mother of God in the fullest sense that her maternity was indestructible. That is, he could die in the flesh, but she would still remain his mother. Whereas every earthly mother, when her son dies, if she has the sadness of seeing a son die, she gave birth to the composite, and now it's been broken. So that's the tragedy of death. So in the case of Our Lady, she was holding him in death, but it was still her son there. Mm-hmm. It wasn't anybody else, and it wasn't just simply a dead body.
Didn't there used to be a celebration in July of the Most Precious Blood?
Right, July 1st, Pius IX established the Feast of the Most Precious Blood of Jesus as a celebration of his happy return from his exile in Gaeta. You know, we had revolutionaries in the Papal States who assassinated his prime minister and then threatened him with violence, and so he fled to Gaeta in the Kingdom of Naples for protection from the Kingdom of Naples. And there he lived, just like the popes fled in various times to like Avignon to get away from, you know, the Italian mobs and all that. I mean, it happened in various times in history. So it's just a little, that's church history. So, but when he was able to return, thanks to the intervention of the French, keeping order in the Holy City, so he's able to return and return to that reduced part of his state that he still had. He established the Feast of the Most Precious Blood to thank God for his deliverance, because, you know, they would have killed him. I mean, it was pretty bad. So that feast was in the general calendar of the church until the new calendar that came in with the revised Mass, the restored Mass under Paul VI. But it still exists in certain places that had a particular devotion to the Precious Blood. So the July 1st feast didn't disappear completely, even from the new calendar. It was in local places. But in the traditional calendar, which is now fully restored and permissible, we can still speak of July the 1st as the Feast of the Most Precious Blood of Jesus. So that's the origin of the feast day. It's Pius IX. Yeah.
And
that goes back to Gaspare de Bufalo, who's a saint, St. Gaspare de Bufalo, who founded the Fathers of the Precious Blood and promoted this devotion and then prevailed on the Pope that if you want God's blessing, if you want to get back to your throne in Rome, you better promise him that you'll set up the Feast of His Precious Blood. So Pius IX, being a good Catholic like all of us, he says, okay, I promise you I'll do this. And then when he got back, he did.
He did it. He kept his promise. Yeah, but yeah. And as you said, the Lord, or maybe I should ask it this way, are you what I got from you earlier, and I want to make sure that I'm correct about this, that the Lord kind of promotes in the church through his saints these devotions, like the devotion to the Most Holy Name of Jesus, to the Sacred Heart, to the Most Precious Blood, in part so that we will be moved to right. be able to be in closer communion with him.
That's why we say devotion, that is, that which suits us, the act for prompt and ready service in the things that regard the service of God. And the things that move us the most, of course, are the things that move us most on the level of humanity. So we have little babies and we have suffering adults, and those things move us.
Yeah.
And that's just in our nature. And our Lord took on both of those forms and consistently, and we see him in his infancy and in his suffering, we're moved, and we realize this is God. You can say, I can serve a God like this.
Yes,
just like
right.
me.
Right.
He suffers, has a heart,
yeah.
he bleeds.
Right. Right. John the 23rd, he points out that Christ began shedding his blood for us at his circumcision.
Right, exactly. Yeah,
is
yeah.
that's...
Yeah. Now, interestingly, the church does not venerate the blood of the circumcision in the litany because it was so far removed from his passion that the idea wasn't necessarily taken up again in the resurrection. So
it's a little awkward,
too. It's a little awkward, yeah. Yeah, right. I could give you some historical details on that devotion, but I think it might be a little much for the radio.
Okay, but the truth is that his entire life is, in a sense, you'll have to correct my language if I'm wrong, but is a life of sacrifice for us.
Absolutely.
Even from
he
his
began
infancy.
From his eighth day, on the, which is the octave day of his birth, He began to suffer the salvation of the world, and he began to shed his blood for us.
And I do think we can be kind of dismissive. There's a kind of cynicism in the modern world. Maybe you haven't noticed that.
No, you haven't noticed. I've been in a monastery for years, so,
so you haven't noticed.
There's never any cynicism in a monastery.
But when you hear, like, oh, in the 15th century, the church was arguing about whether the precious blood of Jesus is adorable or not. Come on, that is so far from, you know, like, people have a kind of cynicism about that.
It's not far from people. You mean theologians? You mean clergy? You mean people corrupted by modern education?
Yeah, yeah.
No.
Yeah, like all of us.
People,
that's what I mean.
No. And ordinary people who have a devotion to Jesus, they're interested in the question.
Yeah.
Like, was it him or not? And then they're happy to see the resolution. So I would say, you know, that we're willing to quibble over which new app is better and which new version of our phone is better.
Right.
We quibble about all kinds of fine details. And then when someone mentions a point of religion, then they act like, well, that's not supposed to be important.
Right.
It's all about being good.
Yeah.
It's all about being a nice person.
Yes, that's what I mean.
Right, the details, like, of the fact that God went to all this trouble for us, and he lived a human life and suffered a whole lot for our salvation and shed his blood and all that, that's not interesting to these people, because they just believe that we're all saved, the anonymous Christian, the,
yeah,
you know, whatever it is, you know, in these crazy theological formulas.
Picking on Karl Rahner.
I'm sorry, I'm picking on him big time. That is, it all makes sense to them, but the fact is the ordinary faithful really do care whether that little drop of the precious blood that they see on the crucifix could have saved them. And we have that in St. Thomas's hymn, by one drop of which,
yeah,
the whole world could be saved.
Right. Yeah, there's a kind of, I don't know what you would call it, but there's a way in which we really are offended by the incarnation in a way, that it's by these physical things, by physical acts, by his blood and by his life and death that we're saved. I don't know what that is, but that seems to be a very, it offends the modern mind.
Well, it's because we've had a long training in rejecting the primacy of our senses and our experience, and for us, our sense and experience are only for sensuality, impurity, ideologies of various kinds, wrath, anger, passions, and the idea that God reaches down to our nature, that is religion is supposed to be something that's completely in the other realm. It's purely moral. It's a moral imperative.
Yeah, right.
The world of sensation is in time and space, and we just have that, and then we consider aesthetic experience a little later on. But in between, it's just all morality, and as long as you're good, it doesn't matter. And then goodness, of course, has nothing to do with your body. But in our religion, the religion of the Bible, what you do with your body is exceedingly important,
yeah,
because that's where you get all your knowledge and all your inclinations.
Yeah.
And so we need to pay attention to that. And that's why God took to himself flesh of the Virgin Mary, and why the earliest presentation of the faith, they don't say God became man, they say God became flesh.
Yeah.
Point out that, you know, it's the reality of our human nature that he took upon himself in order to save us through human experience. And the passion is exactly that, so much that it even goes deeper than the level of flesh experience, down to the very elements of our flesh, that is blood and
right,
flesh and soul, all these things together.
And we're going to have to take a break in just a minute, and so I don't want to get too. I want to let people know when we come back, we're going to talk about what does this tell us about what's actually going on in the Passion of the Lord. What does this tell us about what on that first Good Friday really was going on in the universe and in the spiritual and physical universe? But it does strike me, Father, that this kind of religion that you're describing, which is just purely moral religion, is dull. To the average person, that it's intellectualized, and it makes for it's very hard to if we live kind of in the world as ordinary people, it's hard to make contact with that kind of religion.
Exactly, because you have priests who teach there's a dumb Jesus who died on the cross and didn't know what he was doing, and then he rose from the dead and kind of went, oh, I guess that's who I am, if yeah, they believe that he rose from the dead. So that's a pretty unattractive religion.
Yes, right, and it becomes I think it has to do with the plainness of our churches as well, that we don't we get almost ashamed of the details of the religion.
Right, exactly, absolutely, yeah. Iconography would solve a whole lot of it.
Heal some more, right? Right, and that the blood of Christ is not an incidental detail.
No,
it is
not
that,
at all. And I can give you an example of that when we come back.
Okay, yeah. Father Hugh Barbour is our chaplain here at Catholic Answers. Father is a Norbertine priest. Father, former prior of St. Michael's Abbey, just up the road from us here in Orange County. We're talking about the devotion to the most precious blood of Jesus, and how that devotion to the most precious blood opens up a whole horizon of. For us, of understanding who the person of Jesus is, but also his body and what the parts of his body mean for our own salvation. We'll delve more deeply into that when we come back on this Good Friday. Again, here at Catholic Answers and the whole EWTN family, we wish you and yours a very blessed Good Friday, and as Easter approaches, also a blessed Easter. We'll be right back with more with Father Hugh Barbour after this on Catholic Answers Live.
Got questions? Visit us today at Catholic.com.
50 years ago, Blessed Pope Paul VI released his encyclical Humanae Vitae, reaffirming the Catholic Church's condemnation of contraception. Catholic Answers magazine is marking the anniversary with a very special issue delving deep into what is arguably one of the Church's most controversial documents in modern times. Want to be sure to get your copy? Subscribe right now to the best Catholic apologetics magazine anywhere by calling 818-487-2011 or by going to CatholicAnswersMagazine.com. Don't miss out on what will be a virtual handbook on the most important aspects of Paul VI's profound and prophetic document. Don't wait another moment to subscribe. Call 818-487-2011 or go to the shop at Catholic.com right now to get subscriptions for yourself and those you love. Share the faith. Defend the faith. Catholic Answers Magazine from Catholic Answers, the most trusted name in Catholic apologetics.
Hi, this is Trent Horn, and you've probably heard me explain Catholicism to non-Catholic callers on the radio or engage opponents in formal public debates. I've always hoped these interactions would show people how to graciously defend and share our faith, but they're not enough. That's why I've created a weekly podcast that will help Catholics answer the toughest objections against our faith. Every episode of the Council of Trent will provide listeners with a conversation roadmap that will help them share their faith with anyone. Keep in mind that I hate boring lectures. These podcasts will contain entertaining, informative, and practical explanations of the faith, as well as interviews with the best Catholic writers and speakers in the world today. Visit TrentHornPodcast.com today to find out how you can subscribe to my new podcast. That's TrentHornPodcast.com.
The Trump administration rolls back the Health and Human Services contraceptive mandate.
U.S. bishops calling for the total elimination of nuclear weapons.
Pope Francis offers prayers for the victims of the California wildfires.
The U.S. House of Representatives has passed a bill banning abortions after 20 weeks.
And Pope Francis says the death penalty is contrary to the gospel.
Your link to news headlines Catholics count on at the top of the hour. Weekdays on EWTN Radio.
Catholic Answers Live is brought to you in part by CatholicSingles.com, the website for Catholics who want to meet others who share their Catholic values for faith, fellowship, and love. You can learn more at CatholicSingles.com. Catholic Answers Live thanks CatholicSingles.com for their generous support.
A lot of people think that street evangelization involves yelling out of a bullhorn telling people that they're going to hell. Not so with St. Paul's Street Evangelization. Our methods are non-confrontational and effective. We simply offer information on the Catholic faith along with rosaries, miraculous medals, and prayer. Pope Francis wrote about how beautiful it is to see street preachers joyfully bringing Jesus to every corner of the earth. Street evangelization is fun and fruitful. Join us today at streetevangelization.com.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Thank you so much for being with us. I am Cy Kellett, your host. I am joined in studio by our chaplain, Father Hugh Barbour, Norbertine priest. And we are discussing the devotion to the most precious blood on this Good Friday. Good Friday, the day that we commemorate the sacrifice that the Lord made for us on the cross. And shed his blood for us, blood that we are reminded, as we read in the first half by St. Peter, that it is by the shedding of that precious blood that we are saved. So we call it Good Friday, despite that we all had to ask at some point as a child, why do we call it Good Friday if Christ died on it? And we needed to get the explanation from our mom or dad that God is good. That's what this is. This is what we see is the goodness of God. To tell you the truth, Father, I don't know that there's many people that say, if I was God, I would have done it this way. It's just not the way that humans... Well, I guess it's the ultimate example of my ways are not your ways. My thoughts are not your thoughts.
Yeah, I think that in that statement is a certain level of boredom and lack of depth.
Because, well, thank you.
I mean, when someone says if I'd been God, I would have done it this way. Yeah. Because, basically, look at your life and what you prefer to do each day.
Yeah.
And what if you got a day where you did everything you wanted to do?
Yeah.
At the end of the day, you don't ask yourself the question, if I were God, would I have done it this way? You got what you wanted, and you got your will.
Yeah.
And so I think that what perplexes people about God is that his ways are not our ways, as you point out, and that, his ways are as to us as confounding and detailed and complicated as anything else in the universe.
Yeah.
And we want God to be, in this modern sense, some kind of just general force that validates our behavior or makes us feel good or has some kind of general solution to everything while we go about our business and do as we please. And that's not how it works. God is more detailed, more in the details of human life, including the bad details, than any of our activities. So I think we just underestimate his power.
Yeah.
And so we think, oh, why would he do that? Well, because he's a lot more powerful than you are, and there's a lot more to the story than you think there is. So just keep moving along and try to do what he wants.
Right. If we really kind of attend to nature, not in a scientific way, but in an appreciative way, we kind of get a sense this God is very, very... like a God that would create these bugs over here and this and the stars. And this is a God who's very much in the details.
Orchids. think of it.
Yeah. Right.
He's definitely in the details. So we have to trust him when some of the details are not very pleasant, that he has something in mind.
Yeah. Yeah. So as we discuss the devotion to the most precious blood of Jesus, Saint Pope John the 23rd, called it, and I'm paraphrasing, these are not his actual words, but placed it among the core kind of central devotions of the church. And he said that the devotion to the most precious blood of Jesus, the Sacred Heart of Jesus, and the Holy Name of Jesus, these are devotions that should not be divided from one another, but should always be thought of as in accord with one another. Yeah. I guess we have a tendency to be kind of cliquish, like my devotion's better than your devotion or something.
Yeah. Well, I would say, if you look at the Divine Mercy devotion, which is the most recent and popular, it combines all of those things very clearly because the invocation is Jesus, I trust in you. So there's the real focus on the Holy Name of Jesus. And then he's entering the upper room on the night of his resurrection. And what is he doing? He's showing the blood and water that flowed from his Sacred Heart. And he's showing his wounds and the wound in his side. So you have his Sacred Heart. And you have the precious blood, you have it all there together. The invocation of his name, the revelation of his blood, which is a sign of his love for us, and then his heart from which the blood flows. So the devotions definitely all go together. And then of course, in line with that then is the fundamental devotion, which is to the Holy Cross. That's where our Lord's body laid, that's where his blood was shed, and that's where his name was placed over it, Jesus of Nazareth, King of the Jews. And so we also see in the cross all those things coming together.
Yeah. When you think about this, the way you've you kind of helped us think about in the first half of the program, the blood of Christ as not separate from his divinity, the body of Christ, even in death, not separate from his divinity, it gives a different a different impression of what Holy Saturday is too, where we kind of think, well, nothing's really happening on Holy Saturday. Am I correct there?
Holy Saturday is the most significant day in the history of the world since God created the world. Because on Holy Saturday, according to the church's liturgy, all right, our Lord descends among the dead, and in his soul, which is still united to his divinity, he liberates the souls of the faithful departed who are ready for entering to heaven and gives them the vision of his Father. So you consider everybody that died from Adam and Eve, who repented and were saved, to Abel the just, you know, the first saint in a way, first martyr, because he's the first man to die.
Mm-hmm.
He died before his parents. He endured the pain of death before anyone else, and he died because of his service to God. So Adam and Eve, Abel, and then all the patriarchs and prophets, everybody, all the way until St. Joseph and St. John the Baptist and anybody else that died in God's grace at the time, all of them were waiting to see God. Everything else was taken care of. And when our Lord came, they received the vision of his Father because he had completed the work of salvation. So that you consider that's an innumerable number of people. That's like an explosion, a nuclear explosion of happiness and perfection.
Right. Right. For them, that is there some analogy there? I mean, I know that they're not in a state of purgation before that.
Right.
But they're released into heaven in the way that a soul finishing purgation.
Right.
Is.
The people who died before our Lord's passion, they're the same as we are in the sense that if they needed purification, they went to purgatory.
Mm-hmm.
Some people think that there was no purgatory before Christ, but no, there was purgatory back then, and the Jews believed in it very strongly. They had the images that we have, like in our holy cards, where the blood of Jesus at Mass is being poured by the angels and the souls of the departed. You know, you have those holy cards. Well, the Jews had the notion, too, that the blood of the sacrifices in the temple that were poured down this drain that went into the Kidron Valley, that went down into the center of the earth and relieved the souls of the departed.
Oh.
So they had the same belief that the blood of the sacrifices would help the departed. And so you have our Lord's sacrifice for us. And so those who died before his sacrifice for us, they endured the purifications of purgatory. Once they were purified, they went to what's called the limbo of the just. They were ready for heaven, but there still remained that our Lord should pay the price of bodily death as the new Adam and head of the human race so that everybody could be delivered from the bonds of death. That's what our Lord did. It's a very precise, concrete thing he did. He died in his human nature as the Son of God made man, as the new Adam, and thus he paid completely, because of the infinite dignity of his person, the whole price for the sin of our first parents, so that everybody who was ready to enter heaven could enter heaven. And that's what he did. And so when he says, other sheep have I, or not of this flock, these also must I lead, he was speaking of the departed, according to the fathers. So as soon as he breathed forth his spirit and descends among the dead, he gives them the vision of his eternal Father, and that's an event that can't be compared to anything from, I would just say, maybe the God's creation of Eve from the side of Adam, that might be like the next most important event, but this is when he gave them all, and just think of the love of our Lord there. He was able to give all his ancestors, everyone that's mentioned in the genealogies,
yes,
genealogy of Matthew, genealogy of Luke, this whole, and St. Joseph himself, he was able to give them all the vision of his Father, so it was just like his eagerness to die and to bestow upon them this gift of eternal life. And that's so why Holy Saturday is quiet. It doesn't seem like much is going on, but in point of fact, we celebrate an amazing explosion of divine love and mercy and power on that day.
And what about his body in the tomb? I mean,
and his body in the tomb, of course, remains united to his divinity, so it's adored there by the holy angels, and the holy women keep vigil. That's why the church has always loved the practice of adoring the Eucharist in the meantime during the Triduum. It's a little truncated now because we officially don't have adoration, and we have adoration until midnight of Good Friday, and then after that you still can adore the Blessed Sacrament wherever it is, but it's not official or liturgical. But in the earlier tradition, they had the altars of repose all the way until Easter, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But the fact is that impulse that we should then continue to adore the Lord's body as he descends with his soul among the dead symbolically is there in the practice of visiting the altars of repose. And in many parts of Europe, you know, they would have an image of our Lord lying in death along with the Blessed Sacrament. All that's kind of changed a little bit now. But the fact is the inspiration, as you see in the Eastern Rites with the Lord's winding sheet, and they venerate that. Is definitely an awareness that we need to keep vigil with his body also, because his body is going to rise shortly and will be the instrument of our salvation and also the food for our souls at the Mass of Easter.
So when you talk about, I mean, it was very striking to me when you spoke earlier about his shedding his blood in the streets of Jerusalem. I mean, you think about the scourging, he's shedding his blood. He's carrying the cross. He's shedding his blood from the cross itself. He's shedding his blood. Are you saying that even the angels would adore that blood while he's in the tomb?
Of course, yeah. And preserve it because, as St. Thomas teaches, the particular constituents of our human nature that are meant to be gathered up for the resurrection, and only God knows which ones he intends to gather up, they are protected and gathered by the angels themselves. So our Lord's precious blood was, you could say, kept vigil over, and such parts of it as were meant to be reunited to his body were protected and kept by the holy angels or watched over in view of his resurrection on the third day. So they were keeping a continual, you might say, vigil, not a Eucharistic vigil because it wasn't his Eucharistic blood, but still his true blood. And that gives us the example for the adoration of the Lord's body and blood in the Blessed Sacrament.
And but then I think
and I'm not making this up, you know. It's so different from modern theology that people will listen to it and go, oh, I don't know. You know, if I ask my pastor about that, he's going to say that's all crazy. But, you know, priests nowadays, unfortunately, they haven't studied the traditional theology of the Church in the Summa of St. Thomas, which is the Church's continually recommended source for theology, including the documents of Vatican II, which say that St. Thomas is the guide for dogmatic theology. And if there's any dogma in the Church, it's the dogma of the Incarnation. And the Incarnation involves the consequences and consectaries and colleries of the Incarnation. So just hold fast and don't worry. And don't ask too many questions of your clergy. Just believe. So you won't be discouraged by any stupid answers.
Okay. But this here's something that you said that I got to go back to because I don't understand it.
Okay.
His blood poured out there in the streets of Jerusalem is adorable, that meaning that it can be adored as divine. But you said it's different from the blood of the Blessed Sacrament. Okay. Can you explain that?
And that's where the controversy came, because a certain school of theology, I won't give it a name, but let's say, said that, no, we just adore the Eucharistic blood of the Lord, because in the Eucharist, of course, especially, I mean, since our Lord's resurrection, all of him is together. His body, his blood, his soul, his Godhead, his divinity are all united. Mm-hmm. And so even though we consecrate the bread into the body of Christ and we consecrate the wine into the blood of Christ, we know that his body and blood are united each to each other and to his soul and to his divinity. And so there were those who said, no, the only blood adored by the Church, blood of Christ, is the Eucharistic blood. And of course, it seemed like a fine point because after all, the Passion was long over. Mm-hmm. And since the resurrection, you know, the Church didn't have any other blood but the Eucharistic blood. But it was important to maintain the doctrine of the adorability of our Lord's blood in the Passion in order to keep clear what's going on in his incarnation. And also to keep clear the degree of humiliation and suffering that our Lord endured for our salvation so that we might appreciate it more clearly. So now we have the great privilege of adoring our Lord in his full humanity and divinity with none of the constituents of his humanity and divinity separated.
Right.
But in the Passion, they were separated. And yet, in terms of the mystery of the Eucharist, for example, as St. Thomas says, if someone had kept a little bit of the precious blood and the host after the Last Supper, our Lord would have been undergoing his Passion under those appearances, that is, as his body was separated from his blood, so under the appearances of bread, there would have been no more blood. And as his blood was separated from his body, so under the appearances of his blood, there would have been no body. And as his body was separated from his soul, then the body and soul be separated. But none of it was ever separated from his divinity, and that's what everybody agrees with.
No one agrees
with that, except for the case of his blood, when in a certain school of theology, which I won't mention the name of because I don't want to be contentious, said that no, his blood was separated from his divinity. But that's not what the Church teaches, because in the Litany of the Precious Blood, we invoke the blood of Jesus as shed in the Passion, which means we say, save us. And if it was just dead blood, We wouldn't say, save us.
I think you do want to be contentious. I think you're just resisting that temptation, Father. Well, I think it's very noble of you.
I don't want to be, but I just figured it would be. I want people to believe what I'm saying and not have a reason not to accept it. So
all of this is making, in my mind, it's giving me the image of the leaders of the Jews saying, "His blood be upon us and upon our descendants." Often thought of as, is that what it is? A blood be upon us and upon our children.
Children, right, yeah.
That's thought of as a curse. But this, if you think of the precious blood this way, it really changes the meaning.
Yeah,
I think
there's a holy irony in all that they're calling down upon themselves the blood of pure mercy. They're calling down upon themselves and their children the blood of the Son of God, born of the Virgin Mary. Both his natural blood in the Passion and his Eucharistic blood. So far from recognizing this as a curse, we should rather see that for the Jewish people, insofar as is anybody descended from anyone that was there at the time, because you know the church says we can't blame the Jews for the death of our Lord, the ones who are living now,
yeah,
because they weren't necessarily responsible for it. And many of them are descended from the Ashkenazim, who, of course, were not there at Jerusalem at the time. So let's just say, if anyone called down upon himself the blood of Christ, that's a pretty powerful prayer, even if they didn't understand it. And so I think it gives us reasons for confidence for their salvation and conversion.
Yes, right.
And
right.
So it's not a curse. I mean, it sounds like a curse, but
it's not a
it's
curse.
Not, no.
No. And that's really what, the crucifixion of the Lord, the Passion of the Lord, it transforms everything, even those things that it's like it turns the world. I don't know if it turns the world on its head or if it takes a world that is turned on its head and turns it upright.
It definitely does it. And the Catechism of the Council of Trent, when they couldn't have been accused of being very politically correct, it says that we Christians are more responsible for the Passion of the Lord than the Jews.
Yeah.
Because we know him and we believe in him, and yet still we offend him. And that's there, 17th century.
Right.
No one can make it. No one can blame the Jews. No.
Well, okay. So now you've made it personal, though, because I think that's an important thing. Like, what's for me as a person now living in the 21st century? What does how am I connected to this this blood that poured forth from Christ?
I would say I'll give you a suggestion. If you're interested in that question, which is already a really good thing, if you're already interested in that question, and you are. Is to get a copy of the beautiful book by Father Frederick Faber, who founded the London Oratory of the Oratorian Fathers, a companion of Newman's in reestablishing the Catholic faith in England and with a thriving community there now, and his book, The Precious Blood of Jesus, which deals with this devotion in a very extensive way and explains the theology and the devotion behind it, and will give you all the insight you need. And it's a book that could change your life. It's in a style that we're not used to, but I think it's one that you would find very, very attractive. So Frederick William Faber, Faber, and I'm sure you can get it on Amazon. It's probably available on Kindle. It's probably available on everything.
Yep.
And the title is The Precious Blood of Jesus.
The Price of Our Salvation.
Right,
I found it
right,
here
it's
on
right
Amazon.
Right there. Yep. And just pick that up. It's not expensive. How much did they charge?
$2.99 for the Kindle version.
$2.99 for the Kindle. That's like
$18 for the paperback.
The price of your salvation, $2.99. Are you kidding?
So
Come on.
So you're not going to tell me the answer. You're just going to tell me to read the book.
Well, I just.
Or was that just a?
I wanted to make sure that we covered that.
Okay. Of course.
Also, we recognize that they're what we need to do is just approach with confidence the cross of the Lord on Good Friday and at Easter. Recognizing that we are saved by the precious blood of Christ, and if any of the theology perplexes you or makes you ask questions, one thing is certain, that the testimony of Scripture tells you that we are saved not by any perishable thing, but by the precious blood of Christ.
That being the case, Father, let's say that
you're so scholastic. It's very nice.
What? Oh, that being the
that
case. Oh, is that a scholastic
having
thing?
Said this.
Having said that, I believe I read one time in something written by Bernard Lonergan, he says something like, and in the 23rd place, I know, don't give me the face about Bernard Lonergan,
that's okay.
Very Thomistic, and in the 23rd place, or something
right,
it's some huge number of iterations.
Right,
but
yes,
okay,
right.
So that being the case, Father, say there were a cloth that had touched the face of Jesus. Mm-hmm. What would be the status of the blood on that cloth? Let's say that
blood that he shed, like on the Shroud of Turin or in various relics, that was not taken up in the Passion, would then be simply a material element, worthy of our veneration as an icon, you might say, of his humanity and divinity, but not the actual living Christ himself, which you would find in the Eucharist. So, like, you know, our Lord could leave behind a fingernail or a hair or
something,
or his foreskin that was venerated in Italy and different parts of Europe.
Yeah.
All these different parts of his body that might have been left behind as relics, we don't have to worry about that, because what wasn't taken up in the resurrection is not definitively and permanently part of his nature. And we know that a normal human life, you leave a lot behind.
Yeah, you're shedding skin all the time. You cut
your
hair.
Even though you rise from the dead. And so our Lord's no different from that point of view. But the fact is that his living, fresh humanity that was set aside in the Passion, according to the tradition of the Church, is taken up in the resurrection. I mean, he had to have some blood in his risen body, and he shed most of it. So he had to get it from somewhere, and it was his. Now, this is not something modern theology likes. They don't like this stuff. They think it's kind of primitive and odd.
Mm-hmm.
But we human beings that know about our identity, we're willing to believe that God can do just about anything, and he can certainly raise the dead if he made them, and he can certainly raise the Son of God made man if he accomplished the wonderful mystery of the Incarnation and the Passion.
I would think, Father, it's not very good theology if it's raising doubts about whether God can raise the dead. I mean, that's...
Yeah, I'd agree with you. Fine.
Okay.
Yeah, I agree with you completely, but let's just say
it seems very basic.
There's a lot of not very good theology around.
Maybe I'm too simple. Because
you're not too simple. You're just you're a believer. That's the way we want to keep it.
Okay.
But just you're exactly right. As we say in North Carolina, you're exactly right.
Okay. All right. Well, maybe we could take a moment. I mean, we approach the end of our Good Friday show. And again, a blessed Good Friday to those who have joined us. If you are in a condition where you are not able to make it to a church today, you should be confident in the church's closeness to you and Christ's love for you. And if you are, we hope you were. But Father, I suppose I want to ask you to end on an evangelistic note, evangelizing the world with what happened today on Good Friday. What do we say to the world, not to one another as Christians, but about who this Christ is and what this means that he's given his life for us?
Well, the Savior on this Good Friday recreates the world as he created it in the beginning, and he pronounced it good. And even though it was marred by our sins, he brought it back again by the perfection, the infinite perfection of his love for us. And so this Good Friday gives us every confidence that what God has made from the beginning as good and glorious and perfect is completely renewed and restored by the goodness and mercy and power and the precious blood of the divine Son. So let's put all our trust in him, that whatever struggles we have, whatever trials we fear, whatever difficulties we see in the world or around us, that he has borne them all, and he pronounces the result, the ultimate result, good. This Good Friday is about the result of everything God has done for us, both in his goodness and in our sinfulness. So let's put all our trust in him and trust in his power of his precious blood, his holy name, his heart beating with the precious blood for love of us. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Father. And I guess I could ask this too, because I wanted to get to this. And in Pope John's letter on the precious blood of Christ, he talks about the blood pouring forth is the foundation of the sacraments. And so for those of us who are practicing Catholics, really don't forget how powerful the sacraments are.
Right, exactly. The sacraments of the blood of Christ applied to our souls.
Father, may we have your blessing before we go.
Benedictio Deum Gentis Patris et Filii et Spiritus Sancti, descendat super vos et maniat semper.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you again, Father.
You're welcome.
And a very happy Easter to you, too.
Same to you. God bless you.
Thank you so much for joining us here on Catholic Answers Live. On Monday, I hope you'll come back. We're going to have a two-hour discussion about the resurrection of Jesus on Easter Monday. We celebrate, we Catholics, we have the octave of Easter, so we get to celebrate Easter for 8 days, so we'll be talking about that. On this day, maybe more than any other day, we want to remember Jesus Christ is the light of the nations.